And how do we really sort of ignite a massive creative movement around innovation, doing something extraordinary? That's how you solve problems. And I know myself, I was working at this large tech company. I was well-paid, kind of cushy job. I left with another guy in a 17-page business plan, jumped off the cliff, and had the opportunity to create a great company, 5,000 people, public offering. But the more important storyline here was that I never would have got hired at that company because I didn't have the skill set. Like, I never acquired companies. I never ran a professional services group. But since I started it, I got to learn something extraordinary and create wealth and share that wealth and do some really important things in my life. And that dream is available to everybody. It truly is. And I go back and, you know, I'm kind of like this bohemian guy sort of disguised in this sort of tech exterior. And I think that Timothy Leary and Ron Doss had it really right. Unfortunately, the Summer of Love in 1967 got sort of categorized as a sort of hippie drug craze movement, but it was really all about creativity. And there's a term, a Greek term called kairos, which means right time, right place. And I believe we're at that precipice right now, where we can truly unlock the most extraordinary talent that we have. Whether you want to run your small yoga studio, or three-person company, or a small or medium business, that opportunity should be available for everybody. Everything you want in life, you dream about in your life, should all be there. And we're trapped in this, what I call, zombie conformity, where you watch CNN or whatever, you do the same things. It's all about thinking differently. I'll be talking more about creativity and other opportunities to come, but I also like the catalyst for my talk here is that here's an extraordinary opportunity for all of us, and I want to be helpful and try to unlock all of that. So what I thought I would do is share a local story, and I can actually create a vision board, and I'll talk about that in a moment. But anyone here read Good Times? Anyone happen to read an article this past week about a guy named Chris Sharma? So let me just, I copied just a few of the highlights from the article. But Chris is a native Santa Cruzian. He's traveled the world. And he's basically known as probably the world's greatest rock climber out here in Santa Cruz. The world's absolute best. And Chris has pioneered some of the most difficult routes on Earth. Climbs difficult routes that are completely rope-free. So you may have seen him on the cliffs in Santa Cruz over the water. And he learned to basically take these extraordinary tough tracks. And he doesn't have a rope. And he falls into the water. He's got to deal with like climbing up and getting back up. And going through that training, he said, I've always dedicated myself to climbing at the edge of what is humanly possible. And the story gets much better than that. Chris's climbing coach said that what really sticks out to me about Chris, aside from his genetic gifts, is his mental approach. So we'll talk about that a little bit, like the mental side of your reality is everything. You perceive and live the world the way that you want to construct that. Chris has a Zen-like abandonment and capacity to fire on all cylinders. And the reason why I'm telling this story is it parallels so much of these startups and what the innovation spirit and philosophy is here in Santa Cruz. Chris honed his craft on the boulders in Castle Rock State Park. The experience taught him to have the imagination and envision aggressive climbing lines where none existed before. You think about all these startups out here, everything they're working on, they're doing something entirely new. They're jumping off a massive cliff to take the biggest risk of their lives to solve some real problems, like Chris did. I've always been a talent of mine to identify these beautiful lines that exist in nature. It was Castle Rock that really helped me unlock that potential. Discovering and establishing new lines, Sharma grabbed headlines when he climbed the hardest deep water soloing line in the world on the fade Es Pontas, a natural arc that protrudes from the rollicking Mediterranean Sea just off the southeast coast. Sharma looks at his career both as his accomplishments and his future goals with a meditative sense of calmness that's uncommon in his hyper-competitive field. Chris's quote was, I want to keep pushing the limits and finding beautiful things, finding ways to inspire people and share this great sport. It's been an honor to be part of an evolution of rock climbing. So that story was just extraordinary for me, and it really touched into the companies I'm working with, what Heather and Santa Cruz Works has done here today. So I thought what I would put together is a vision board. I want to to share with everyone. I'm going to leave this here with Santa Cruz Accelerates. I'm going to ask the companies that are involved here to come up and sign it. Anyone that wants to sign it is welcome to do that. But I titled it Entrepreneurship and the Super 7 Zen. And here's the article that Chris talked about. And I've captured some of Chris's quotes here that I read to you throughout. And then what I put together was thinking about my experiences in entrepreneurship, working with one of the greatest innovators of all time, Elon Musk, and how he thinks about the world and the types of products that he builds and how it's completely changing the world in some of the hardest industries of transportation and electricity generation. And I thought I'd put that, what I put together, what I call the Super 7 Zen. So my advice to all both future, present and future entrepreneurs is sort of a recipe of the 7 Zen things that you should be focused on. Without, if you fail on any of these, you're not going to get there. So number one is tap into your awesome creative powers. You all have it. Everyone in this room has the most extraordinary creative talent that you could ever imagine. Jeff Bezos talks about how he typically likes to literally think himself into a mode when he was 10 or 11 or 12 years old. He's in this very childlike state. And he gets to think about the world in an entirely different way. As a matter of fact, while I was at Stanford, I had a neuroscientist who wrote a book and talked about the human brain. And actually, at 2 to 3 years old, you have more neurons in your brain, and the electrical map is at its peak when you're 2 or 3. And then society starts to pare that back. So like anything, if you don't use a certain muscle, it atrophies. And as your brain starts to sort of conform to life here on planet Earth, it then begins to shrink. So at 50, you have half of the neurons that you had when you were 2 or 3 years old. And I would invite everyone to like fire your neural network back up. Everything is possible in this world. Elon actually, in 2008, took his entire fortune from PayPal and bankrolled it all into SpaceX and Tesla. He was very close to bankruptcy. He put everything he had into seeing this dream of space exploration and completely changing transportation and completely changing the dynamic around climate change. He got to the near brink of extinction and pulled it out. But it really starts with this opportunity and this ability that we all have to explore. There's lots of ways to do that, but I'll leave it at that for right now. That could be a whole separate topic. Number two, it's vision. And a lot of times, when I started my company, I met with 50 venture capitalists, 49 said no. 49 said, that's the stupidest idea I ever heard. This is never gonna be successful. You don't know what you're doing. And the list goes on and on. It didn't deter me, because I knew that this idea was a good idea. And it turned out the company had a public offering, was worth $3.5 billion, so I guess it wasn't that stupid after all. But it largely starts with, most of the time, if someone's telling you no, that probably means you're on the right track. And if they're telling you yes, then you're just following someone else. And it's really all about basically thinking differently, exactly. Thinking differently, thinking outside the box, and really challenging yourself and tapping into this extraordinary ability that you have. And it's easy to get in that space. You live here in Santa Cruz, literally drive right down to the coast, close your eyes, and just meditate for 10 minutes. And start doing that more often, and you're gonna be amazed at the ideas and what starts to happen in your brain. It's extraordinary. Number three, soulful passion. And the reason this is so important is that startups are incredibly hard. They're gonna suck the life out of you. And if you're not loving what you're doing, if you're not really mission-driven, when those hard times come, and trust me, they're going to, you're gonna quit. You're not gonna like it. And so it either is something that you believe to your core, that you believe in your soul so deeply, and you're willing to basically do everything ethical to get there, but if you don't check that box, now's not the right time to go do a startup. Everything starts with passion. And number four, unrelenting commitment and focus. So this is not something like, hey, I just want to give it a shot and see how it goes. This is something that you dedicate, you think about it, and you dedicate every molecule in your body, every fiber of your being to this endeavor, because you're passionate about it and you believe it so much. And you're this, and I always talk about this, the journey truly is the prize. The money is just an attribute of it. If you love what you're doing, you're passionate about it, you're truly committed to it, and you may find out you may get down the dead end road. My company pivoted a ton of times. Every founder out here, they've already pivoted. That's just natural course. They've probably pivoted, right? So it's not that you have to get it right out of the box. You're never not going to get it right out of the box. But the learning lesson is that nothing is going to go right. The best plans you have, the best spreadsheet that you have, business model, it's going to take some twists and turns along the way. Number five, this is really important. Do something you're good at. I started out wanting to be a programmer, and I'm a type A guy. I like to be the best at what I do, and I found out I was against an average programmer at best. I've been good about finding mentors in my life, and I was really frustrated, and I went to talk to the vice president of my department and said, Toby, what do you want to do with your life? And I said, I want to run my own company someday. I want to start my own company someday. And he said, go into product management. So that's my inside joke. What I do is shitty programmers and make product managers. But the point being that I could be an average programmer, or I could find something that I'm way better at. So, like, could I figure out maybe how to, dissect some DNA? Maybe. But there's probably people way better than that. But I found that I'm good at other things. And I explored that, and I began to master those skills. And that's okay. It's having a really good sense of self-awareness. But focus on something that you're good at. And number six, do something that creates value. The number one reason why all startups fail is lack of product market fit. And that means that for whatever reason, it just didn't solve a big enough problem. Our customers weren't willing to pay enough money for it. It was too expensive to reach them and communicate what your great product was. So really focus on the value side of it. You're solving a real problem, or you're delivering an extraordinary innovation that changes the world. But was the world asking for a computer that runs in the palm of your hand? No. But Steve Jobs had a vision for an extraordinary digital world, created this thing called the iPhone that completely changed the world, right? Billions and billions of applications on this platform. But focus on something that creates value. And lastly, entrepreneurship truly is a lifestyle. It's not something that's a part-time job or a side job. It's something that is going to consume all of your life. Make sure your family and loved ones, and it's something that is truly becomes part of you, becomes your essence, becomes who you are. And that was sort of my advice to this group. So you focus on sort of the super Zen 7. I got some photos up here. One of the greatest entrepreneurs of all time, my favorite Willy Wonka. What extraordinary vision he had. And I'm excited to be here. I'm excited to be part of this extraordinary program. I went over my 10 minutes, I normally always do. I'm humbled, I'm truly humbled to be here. This is an extraordinary community. We live in a really, really special, we all live in a really, really special place. I feel this incredible energy, this soulful energy here. Thanks for your time. I'm gonna turn it back over to Heather.